Okay, so hello everyone and welcome to Unacademy platform. Let's crack Neet PG. Myself Dr. Muskan Chaudhary and I will be your mentor for microbiology. So before starting today's topic, that is Shikila, and the topic has been taught before in the introductory class of microbiology, and we'll study in brief about the same topic today, and this will be a short session for the topic Shigella from the Enterobacteriaceae family. Now before starting the topic, let me acknowledge you with Unacademy platform. As we know, Unacademy is India's largest learning platform, and along with the daily life class, it gives the structured course and the test and quizzes. So before starting today's topic, let me acknowledge you with the Unacademy platform. Just a second. Okay, so the daily life class, the biggest advantage is that educator and the student can interact with themselves and can engage in the discussion, can ask their doubts and do the answer polling, and that too within the live class is going on. And within the live test, the student can evaluate the preparation with a regular mock test and the quizzes, and can detail analysis of his performance before the exam is being held. Now, as we know, the completing the whole 19 subjects within the 5.5 years is a great target. So to get the same subjects covered within a short period of span from 8 to 9 months is something that structure study along with the regular mock test and a continuity, consistent and study, hard work along with the smart mark is something that is needed. So our biggest advantage is student can keep the sessions recorded and can watch the videos whenever they feel like. And according to the comfort zone, whenever they are in OPD or the night shift and day shift, especially for those doctors who are the periphery or the medical officers and who are married and a shortage of the time. So please do use my code, that is Muskan. To get extra 10% benefit on subscription, and I will recommend you to have at least 1 to 2 year subscription. 1 year is mainly for those students who are the internship or are the droppers and the freshers, and the 2 years are especially for those students who are in the second year, third year, and are having a time for before the exam, and to they can just keep their basics clear. And for those doctors who do not get sufficient of the time and having a backup plan for the next day, because this year the preparation, they know that they will want to get the sufficient of the time, so they will be, or those who want to improve their ranks and are in the mid-year or in the have not prepared yet, so they can take the 2 year subscription. And to get 10% benefit, please do use my referral code, that is Muskan. Okay, so before starting today's topic, that is Shigella, let me tell you about the Enterobacteriaceae family. The Shigella belongs to the Enterobacteriaceae family, and it is gram negative, non-sporing and facultative anaerobe. So it is gram negative, non-sporing, facultative and anaerobe, and all of them are motile by Peritrichus flagella, that is present all around the surface of the bacteria. So they are Peritrichus flagella. All are motile, but as we know, all everything including all always have exception. So exceptions of the non-motile bacteria from the Enterobacteriaceae family can be remembered by the mnemonic, that is SASSY is non-motile, that is Shigella, atypical E. coli. Salmonella are motile, but among the Salmonella, Salmonella gallinorum are immotile, and Y4, Yersinia pestis, and along with that the Klebsiella, they are non-motile gram-negative bacteria belonging to the Enterobacteriaceae family. So this can be remembered by the mnemonic SASSY is non-motile or SASSY is rigid. So it's a name of a girl, SASSY, and she is rude, so SASSY is rigid. or non-motile, it's important, it will help you to remember the name of the bacteria, because this is asked the exceptions of the non-motile bacteria from the Enterobacteriaceae family, because they are motile by the Peritrichus flagella. So they are gram-negative aerobes or facultative anaerobic. Facultative anaerobic means that if the in the presence of if oxygen is not present, they can use the they can still survive for by not using the oxygen for respirations. And aerobes bacteria use oxygen for the respiration. And coming to their non-fastidious, matlab fastidious matlab that are very specific and they require special nutrients in the medium for their growth, and they are non-fastidious, that is they can grow in the simple media, and all of them grow on the McConkie agar, which is an indicator media, differential media as well as selective media. So they all grow on the simple media. They can grow in the ordinary media like the nutrient agar, and they ferment glucose and reduce nitrate to nitrite. That is important to remember, that is they reduce nitrate to nitrite. And they all are oxidase negative, this is important, they all are oxidase negative and catalase positive, but one exception, as usual exceptions are there. So exception will be Shigella dysentery type 1, that is catalase positive. Now they are generally motile except Shigella and Klebsiella, and other examples I've already told you. So they reduce nitrate to nitrate, they are oxidase negative, they are catalase positive, they are motile by Peritrichus flagella. Exception is the Sesi, and that is Yersinia, Shigella, Salmonella, Gallinarum and A4 atypical E. coli, and along with that Klebsiella. So these are non-motile and gram-negative bacteria belonging to the Enterobacteriaceae family. Now coming to the classification of Enterobacteriaceae according to the lactose fermenters, that is two are present, one is lactose fermenters and non-lactose fermenters. Just remember non-lactose fermenters by shifts, that is SH for Shigella, Yersinia, P for Proteus, and S for Salmonella. So these are the non-lactose fermenters, and the rest will be lactose fermenters. And coming to the those which will lactose ferment lactose, they will produce the pink colored colonies, and those who will not, they will produce the pale colored colonies. And this is the mnemonic to remember, I have told you, that can be remembered. Non-lactose fermenters can be remembered by the shifts, that is Shigella, Yersinia, Proteus and the Salmonella. Now it's not important to remember lactose fermenters, because one is more important to remember, other you will remember that the rest of the are the lactose fermenters. Now coming to the McConkie agar, the constitution of the McConkie agar is important to remember, that is McConkie agar is composed of plant. Now what is plant? P4 pepton, L for lactose, A for agar, N for neutral red as indicator, and T for taurocollate, that is bile salt. So this is the mnemonic to remember the McConkie agar, and the Enterobacteriaceae is lactose fermenter, and the non-lactose fermenter, the example is by Schiff's. Now moving next to the Shigella. Shigella are the agent of the bacillary dysentery, and the this is further classified on the basis of the somatic antigen. And on the basis of the somatic antigen, four classification is done. So that is the Shigella dysentery, Shigella flexionary, Shigella boidi and Shigella soni. So the hardest is the Shigella soni, it is hardest as well as the most common in the world. And while in India, it is important to remember which is the most common in the world and the most common in the India. And in India, the most common is the flexionary. Okay. So it can the flexionary is common in India, and the Shigella soni is common in the world. And the infective dose of important to remember of Shigella, the Shigella is infective in the low dose, that is 10 to 100 bacilli, While the E. coli is infective in 10 is to power 6 to 10 is to power 8, and while the this E. coli O157 is infective in less than 10 bacilli, so it is very infective. So Shigella is infective in 10 to 100 bacilli only, while the cell Molina in 10 to 3 power 3 to 10 is to power 6, and Vibrio colony in 10 is to power 6 to 10 is to power 8. And E. coli is a part of natural flora also, so high amount of E. coli is required to infect the person. So it is same, that is 10 is to power 8, same as that of the Vibrio cholerae. While the Salmonella is important, 10 is to power 3 to 10 is to power 6. Now coming next to the classification, as I told you, 4 classification is done based on the somatic O antigen and the fermentation of the glucose and the mannitol, that is Shigella, Shigella dysentery, Shigella flexneri, Shigella boidii, and Shigella soni. Now coming to the mannitol fermentation, the mannitol fermentation is present in all these three, while Shigella dysentery is exception. It is not present, mannitol fermentation is not present here, as well as it is also catalase negative, while the rest of them are the catalase positive. And also they all are non-lactose fermented, only apart from the Shigella soni. That is the common in the West, most common in the world, and it is what? Late lactose fermenter. So what are the exceptions? Coming to the Shigella dysentery, it is two exceptions are there, that is mannitol fermentation is absent, along with it, it is catalase negative, while the rest of them are catalase positive. So the first and the last ones are exception. First one is the catalase negative and non-mannitol fermentation. And last one is late lactose fermenter, while the rest of them are non-lactose fermenter. So Shigella is an exception among the Enterobacteriaceae family, that it is non-lactose fermenter, and Shigella soni is exception among the exception, that is late lactose fermenter. So the first one and the last one forms the two exceptions. Also the amongst them, the most severe is the Shigella dysentery, and the most common is the Shigella soni in the world. And the flexneri is the most common in the India. Okay, so moving next, the culture media that the chemical reactions I already told you, that is they are catalase positive and mannitol fermentation present. Along with that, they reduce nitrate to nitrite. Okay, so culture media, common media, they are both common for the Shigella and the Salmonella. Now the transport medium that we use is basically sac, buffered, glycerol saline media, and along with this Carey-Blair media. They both media are used as the transport media. One is the sac, buffered, glycerol media, and another is the Carey-Blair media used for the transportation of the organism. And the selective media, that is deoxycholate agar, citrate agar, and the XLD and Shigella salmonella agar. Along with this enrichment broth, that is gram negative selenite F broth and tetrathionate broth. The media of the Shigella and the salmonella are important to be remembered because direct questions are being asked. And and now coming to the important biochemical, we have discussed. Now one more, Hekonki, his media is also used, that is hectoin antric agar media, that is also a selective media, and the colony gives green colonies appear. Now on the Salmonella Shigella agar, black colony occur. For Salmonella. Now coming to the important biochemical properties, we have discussed that it is Shigella is an exception of the motility in the Enterobacteriaceae family. So it is non-motile, non-lactose fermenter, except Shigella soni, that is very important to remember, that is late lactose fermenter. And it is catalase positive except for the Shigella dysentery type 1, that is catalase negative. Mannitol fermentation except Shigella dysentery, that also forms the exception here, that is not mannitol fermentation. does. So pathogenicity now transfer, it occurs through the contaminated, it occurs by the direct fecal-oral route, and the most common, it one important thing that is that it is strict human disease. Bacillary dysentery is strict human disease, and it transfers by fomites, fingers, that is most common, and lice, food and water or flies. And those important points from a strict human disease, and the contaminated fingers is the most common. By fecal bit water and flies and the fingers it transferred, and rarely by the homosexuals. Now coming to the infective dose, I've already told you the infective dose is about 10 to 100 bacilli. That is with low infective dose, it is pathogenic. And another bacteria that is also pathogenic with low infective dose is enterohemorrhagic E. coli, Giardia, and Entamoeba histolytica. EHEC is important to remember. Along with this, we have talked that Vibrio cholerae and E. coli both are infective at 10 is to power 6 to 10 is to power 8 per bacilli, and Salmonella 10 is to power 6 to 10, 3 to 10 is to power 6. Now, bacilli enters what happens in the intestine. Intestinal epithelial cells and cells are also present. So, they directly enter the mucosa of the intestine via the M cells and moves into the mucosal cells. Now, very special motility is present in the cell molena, that is, since they are non-motile, so another special property is present for the motility of the bacteria, that is, the cell-to-cell spread occurs. That occurs by the inducing actin. So, actin is a muscle filament and helps with the movement for the direct cell-to-cell spread of the this pathogen, that is Shigella, within the cells. So invasion is by large, it is important to remember that invasion is plasmid mediated and via M cells and by inducing the actin polymerization. So this is important to remember. Now exotoxin, Shigella exotoxin is found essentially in the Shigella flexneri. It is important, and that is Shigella dysentery type 1 also produce exotoxin, that is Shigella enterotoxin 1 and 2. Now Shigella toxin is important. It is cytotoxin produced by the Shigella dysentery type 1. So Shigella enterotoxin is produced by the Shigella flexneri, and Shigella toxin is important to remember that it is produced by the Shigella dysentery type 1. Now endotoxin induces intestinal inflammation and the ulceration. Exotoxin is important to remember, that is Shigella toxin is important, that is produced by the Shigella dysentery type 1. Since it is gram-negative, and gram-negative bacteria produce endotoxin, so endotoxin is itself is a virulent property of the gram-negative bacteria. So coming to the complications, before the complication, we'll see the mechanism of action, how does it act. Now what happens is that binding of the Shigella, as I told you that the bacilli directly enters the M cells that are present within the intestinal epithelial cells. Now direct cell to cell spread occurs, and it moves to the bloodstream, and the toxin binding takes place. And once the binding takes place, the toxin enters into the host cell, and it causes the breakdown of 60S ribosomal unit. So it inhibits the synthesis of the protein. So what are the other bacteria that also inhibit the synthesis of protein that can be remembered by the don't synthesize protein, that is D4 diphtheria, Clostridium diphtheria, S4 Shigella, and P4 Pseudomonas. Along with the Shigella, EHEC, enterohemorrhagic E. coli also does not produce, does the same mechanism of action of toxin by inhibiting the protein synthesis, by inhibiting the elongation factor 2 and decreasing the protein synthesis. So no translation will takes place. No translation, no protein synthesis, and cell will be dead without protein. So So how does it act by the protein synthesis inhibitor? And other bacteria that also inhibit protein can be remembered by the mnemonic. It is own synthesized protein, that is diphtheria, shigella and pseudomonas, and along with that EHEC is also protein synthesis inhibitor. Now what does it do? That it has the it binds with the endothelial cell. It is sensitive for the endothelial cell receptors, and it binds with the endothelial cells. The endothelial cells causes the coagulation of the blood vessels. So it will, what does, will it cause, just a second. Okay, so it will cause the coagulation of the blood vessels. That it will cause the coagulation of blood vessels and the platelets accumulation will occur at the site. And since the platelet have accumulated at the local site, the RBC moving through the bloodstream, they will also accumulate same here, causing the breakdown of RBC. Also, the endothelial cells of the glomerulus will also be damaged and later causing the hemolytic uremic syndrome. The hemolytic uremic syndrome, as we know, composed of three things. That is, one is anemia. Anemia is occurring because due to breakdown of the RBCs, due to decreased platelet, that is the platelets are consumed at one local site due to the endothelial damage. And another is the acute kidney injury due to involvement of the glomerulus due to attachment of the shiga toxin to the endothelial cells, causing the hemolytic uremic syndrome. Now shigella causes the hemolytic uremic syndrome. Which other bacteria also causes the hemolytic syndrome? That is EHEC. These important to remember, that these two bacteria causes the hemolytic uremic syndrome. Now what are the complications of the shigella or bacilli dysentery? That is the intestinal complications. Now most important clinical symptoms with the bacilli dysentery is that fever, abdominal cramps, and the blood along with mucus in the stool is important, that bloody diarrhea will occur. And what are the complications? Complications are intestinal complications. The first interaction is well in intestine, so with the colon and the rectum, it causes invasive diarrhea because the bacteria is directly invasive into the cell. It causes invasive diarrhea, and the most common site for the invasive for the site of invasion is the rectum and colon. So intestinal complications such as toxic megacolon, perforation within the intestine and the rectal prolapse, along with the toxic neuritis, reactive arthritis and hemolytic uremic syndrome. Now what are the metabolic complications such as the hypoglycemia due to electrolyte imbalance, due to bloody diarrhea causing the hyponatremia and the dehydration. And Ikiri syndrome, it is important to remember that Ikiri syndrome is caused by the shigella, or toxic encephalopathy is a metabolic complication of the shigellosis. And post-infective phase, patients expressing HLA-B27 will develop the reactive arthritis. Reactive arthritis is also important to remember. And HUS, I will told you the mechanism. So HUS is important, reactive arthritis, Ikiri syndrome, intussusception, toxic megacolon. These are some important complications of the shigella. Now this is the definition that I have already told, that most common site is the sigmoid colon and rectum for bacilli dysentery, and the pathological features are same, exit inflammation and diffuse fibrosis. Now clinical manifestation, high fever, abdominal cramps and stool mixed with pus is important, that is bloody diarrhea along with abdominal cramps and the tenderness. These are the complications, that intussusception, toxic hemocolic, toxic neuritis, reactive arthritis is important, HUS is important, and other bacteria that causes the HUS is EHEC. So moving next to the treatment. Now because of the coming to the treatment of the shigella, now one important thing is that bacilli dysentery is self-limited. since it is self-limited and that too within 6 to 8 days. Maintenance of the fluid and electrolyte balance is the basic mode of the treatment, along with no antibiotic is need to be given for the treatment of the dysentery in case of the very young. But in case of the very young, severe or old patient, we will do first antibiotic sensitivity testing and we'll accordingly treat with the antibiotic. Mainly third generation cephalosporins are given. So basic treatment is that it is self-limited and the treatment is not needed. Self-limited disease between 6 to 8 days and no antibiotics is basically needed for the treatment. But in case of the low immunity or the severe or the old or very young patients, we do the antibiotic sensitivity test and then give the third generation cephalosporin. So in addition to ORS, ciprofloxacin is given. Alternative drugs, ceftriaxone, azithromycin and some fifth generation quinolones, but important is to remember this. And duration of the treatment is mainly 3 days in case we are given external treatment of antibiotics. But in case of Shigella dysentery, that is the most severe dysentery, we give in 5 days treatment. And in case of immunocompromised, seven to 10 days. So important is to remember that it is self-limited and no antibiotics generally required. In case if required, we give ciprofloxacin. And the one more thing that as I told you, that Shigella is an invasive, just a second. That Shigella causes invasive diarrhea. So we do the pro-invasiveness test to check the virulency of the this Shigella. Pro-invasiveness test is done, that is Sanary test. Now what we do in the Sanary test, that on the eye of the rabbit, we do the bacterial sensitivity by putting it on the eye of the rabbit. And if the rabbit eye gets the keratoconjunctivitis, if the rabbit gets the keratoconjunctivitis, so that means the invasiveness of the bacteria is present, that means the Sanary test is positive. Now another bacteria that gives the Sanary test is same from the E. coli, and it is enteroinvasive E. coli. From its name we can remember the enteroinvasive, so it is also invasive, so it will give pro-invasive net test. And what is the pro-invasive net test? That is Sanary test. So it also gives the pro-invasive net test. Now the before doing the question answers, let me revise the topic. Okay, so the enterobacteriaceae family, the members of the enterobacteriaceae family are motile by the peritrichus. Exceptions are the Sesi, that is Sesi is non-motile for the Shigella, Salmonella, Gallinarium, for the atypical E. coli and the Yersinia, and they are aerobes, so the facultative aerobes. So they are catalase positive and oxidase negative. The exception for the catalase positive is Shigella dysentery type 1, that is catalase negative, and this, it's also a mannitol fermentation is also not present in the Shigella dysentery type 1. So they are non-fastidious, so they can be grown in the simple media or requiring just basically with the nutrient agar, and they will ferment the glucose and they are generally motile. Exceptions I have already told you. Now coming to the lactose fermenters and the non-lactose fermenters can be remembered by the mnemonic shapes, that is Shigella, just a sec, Shigella, Yersinia, Proteus and Salmonella. Now amongst the, this also, this one is a non-H2S producer. The starting two are the non-H2S pore producers and the last two are the gas producers. So Proteus and Salmonella, we produce the gas. Now coming to the meconchia, it is differential media, indicator media, and it is used for the growth of the enterobacteriaceae. So a plant is for use for the mnemonic to remember the composition. It's Fepton, lactose, agar, neutral red and taurocollate. Now coming to the Shigella species are the agent of the bacillary dysentery, and the four species are present, that is Shigella dysentery, flexneri, boidi and soni. Now Shigella dysentery is Shigella soni is most common in the world, along with the hardest and the most common in the India. Shigella flexneri and Shigella dysentery is the Shigella flexneri is the most common in the India, and Shigella dysentery is the most severe. Now infective dose is low, that is only 10 to 100 bacilli, and the Salmonella typhi, the infective dose 10 to the power 3 to 6. Vibro and E. coli is same, that is 10 to the power 6 to 8. Apart from the E. coli 0157, that is very virulent, in less than 10 bacteria is more per ml is more efficient to cause the pathogenicity. Classification is same. I already on the basis of the somatic O antigen that causes the ferment along with the fermentation on the glucose and the mannitol. Now culture media we use culture media is common for the both Shigella and Salmonella, and among the transport media is the sac, buffered glycerol, saline media, and Carey Blair media is used. And selective media DCA, XLD, and SS agar along with the his media is used. That is hectoin enteric media is used for, and it gives green colored colony. Now important biochemical properties we have discussed. Enrichment media is a negative broth, selenate F broth, and the tetrathionate broth. Now enrichment media, selective media are same, but the basic difference is that the enrichment media is in the liquid form, and they both inhibit the growth of the undesired bacteria and promote the growth of the desired bacteria. So for the pathogenicity, fingers, fomites and lights are the mode of the transmission, sometimes homosexuals, and it is Shigella is invasive bacteria directly into the M cells of the intestinal epithelial cells, and they causes the actin cell to cell direct spread is present due to the actin polymerization, causing the rapid spread of the Shigella. And it is plasmid mediated invasion that is important, and the amount that is required for infected is just 10 to 100 bacilli. Shigella toxin is important that is produced by Shigella dysentery type 1. Now complications that is causes the Akiri syndrome is a metabolic complications, and reactive arthritis is important, which is present in those HLA susceptible patients, and hemolytic uremic syndrome along with the intestinal perforations and toxic megacolon, because the most common site is the sigmoid colon and the rectum for the invasiveness of the bacteria. So this is the same, the patient will present with acute onset abdominal pain, cramps, and along with the bloody diarrhea, that is important to remember. Now complications we have discussed. Now coming to the treatment, it is self-limited and 6 to 8 day treatment, 6 to 8 it will resolve within 6 to 8, and the treatment is not further given, no antibiotics, only supportive treatment of the fluid management is electrolyte management is done due to along with the ORS due to this hyponatremia that occurs to dehydrations, and if antibiotic is given, third generation cephalosporin is given, and ciprofloxacin is the drug of the choice. Now one more thing, that is saline test we have discussed, to the saline test to discuss the invasiveness of the bacteria, and we do for the Shigella and enterohemorrhagic E. coli, both will cause the formation of the keratoconjunctivitis on the rabbit eye when exposed to the bacilli, exposed to the bacteria. So this will cause the this will show the invasiveness of the bacteria. Now coming to the hemolytic uremic syndrome, can most common causative organism we have discussed, this is the most common organism is Shigella, and along it causes the EHE caused by the EHEC enterohemorrhagic E. coli. Now all are the catalase positive. We have seen that the Shigella dysentery type 1 is exception for one thing, is that it is the most severe, and along with that it is catalase negative and non-mannitol fermentation. And the last one, that is Shigella soni, it is the most common in the world and late lactose fermenters, while rest are the non-lactose fermenters. So the answer, all are catalase for exception is Shigella dysentery type 1. In tropical countries, bacillary dysentery is by the Shigella flexneri, because flexneri is the most common in the India, in the West, and in the world. Soni is the most common, and it also the hardest. Now, which of the following toxins can inhibit the protein synthesis? That is, don't synthesize protein. That is D4 diphtheria, Clostridium diphtheria, S for Shigella, and P for Pseudomonas, and one extra, that is EHEC. Now that is the one is the Shiga toxin that is acted by the protein synthesis inhibitor. Okay, thank you for today's session. The today's session was very short and just on the topic Shigella. So I hope that you people have do have liked the video, and please do use my code, that is Muskan, to get 10% off discount on the benefit on the NEET PG subscription. If you are preparing for the NEET PG through the Unacademy platform, please do use my code, that is Muskan, and you will get the best of best material from the all topmost educators all over India on the Unacademy platform. So thank you for today's late night session, and have a good tight sleep, and before that study well if you are the night readers or night person, and just in case you are working in the hospital, so we try to be safe, and if you are not working, just sitting in the home and studying, so be safe even at home. So